Welcome, Kayla, and thank you for joining me today. I'm so excited to have you. So, how are you?
I'm wonderful. I had a very early morning this morning. And actually, our steps challenge at Kohler just started yesterday. So I started off my steps challenge super strong and I got 21,000 steps yesterday. So I'm
That's
trying
so
to show up
fun.
our team. I'm super competitive. I'm trying to show everyone up. So I'm very excited now. Like at lunch, I have to do my walk today. So I'm feeling good. Got some good exercise in the
Yay.
past couple days.
Love it. All that employee engagement. We'll get
Yes.
into that in a second, too. Fun, fun. All right, let's get right into it. So, first, tell me about what you do at Kohler.
Yeah, absolutely. So I am a project leader for our sustainability and our social impact team. So really looking at, we'll talk about kind of more the structure of Kohler's CSR work, but I really cross-pollinate between several different teams at Kohler, and my main functions are essentially program managing. So we have two programs that I manage, both employee engagement programs, and then I also work on a lot of just strategic projects relating to our corporate social responsibility work. So a lot of project management as well as program management.
Awesome. Sounds like they keep you busy.
Yes, they do.
So, back to that question of structure. How is CSR structured at Kohler?
Yeah, so it's a great question. And I feel like even in some of the associates I've worked with at different companies across both Wisconsin and the globe, really, it's so different in every business. And Kohler, we have it structured because Laura Kohler is our Senior Vice President of Human Resources, Stewardship, and Sustainability. So she oversees a lot of the HR space. So because of that, our whole program is really housed within HR. And it honestly makes sense if you think about what's the one area of a business that impacts literally every employee. It is HR, right? Everyone needs HR. When you get hired on, you go through HR. So a lot of our work, it spans every area of every business. So we're housed there and we have our program structured in, I call it the umbrella of believing in better. And beneath our umbrella of believing in better, it's our better planet, better communities, and better lives. So those are our three pillars that we really focus all of our work in. And they're all very, very different in the type of work that they're doing, the teams that are on them. But we have it structured under that really kind of believing in better, larger umbrella as we think about our story at Kohler and how we want to tell that. So we'll get into that in a little bit. But I think that having that understanding that we're in a space where we're impacting all of our employees and our structure is really focused on the story that we want to tell versus just saying, okay, well, here's our CSR program at Kohler and it's housed within our HR business.
Oh, I really like that. I feel like the structure can be a lot different from company to company, and this sounds really innovative. So I love that. So this next one might be a little loaded, but take it wherever you want. So what sorts of activities do you do within the CSR department?
Yeah, it's absolutely a loaded question. So, but I think a good way to think about it is that because we have that larger umbrella believing in better and the three pillars below it, each of those pillars is a separate team with separate strategic initiatives and separate types of programming that they do. So, there's in any given day, if you're lucky enough like me to cross-pollinate between all of these teams, you'll see that the expertise on these teams, the types of people working, the types of projects they're working on are vastly, vastly different, still all buttoning up to the whole corporate social responsibility theme of believing in better. But the activities range, I would say, so looking at each pillar, our Better Communities pillar is really about looking at the communities that Kohler lives and works in and serving those communities in a way through philanthropy, through art, through community giving, partnership with nonprofits, through volunteering, things like that. So our stewardship team is really focused in that space. And we also, you and I talked about as well, that there's a crossover between the DE&I work that Kohler does and our Better Communities work. So we're really seeing more of an effortless tie-in between DE&I and then our Believing in Better strategy. Then moving to our Better Planet strategy. So that's really, that team is focused on environmental sustainability work. So we're looking at very tactical, technical projects relating to reducing our water footprint, our greenhouse gas footprint, our waste footprint, all of those. So there's those key projects as well as our associate engagement, which I kind of I'm a specialist, if you will, in that space for our sustainability work. And we have our Sustainability Champions program, which we'll talk about. But a lot of our focus in the environmental sustainability space is on that footprint reduction and also collaborating with all of the different types of businesses that Kohler has, because there's so many of them. So we're constantly collaborating and helping them come up with their strategic goals for their businesses, as well as helping them kind of keep moving some of the key projects that they have going on. And then lastly, in the Better Lives pillar, a lot of that work is centered around innovation. So new product development, all relating to giving back for the social good. So Kohler, when we really talked about initially starting our whole corporate social responsibility program, and especially our environmental sustainability work, we looked at the sustainable development goals and said, which of these goals honestly makes the most sense for our business that we could make the biggest impact on in the work that we do. So our Better Lives pillar is really unique in that we have our Innovation for Good team there. And there's essentially two facets to that team. The first is really new product development, but it's new product development with that social good kind of lens on it. So we're thinking about, okay, in developing countries where there is minimal to almost no access for water, how could we create something like a waterless toilet to service people? So communities can have better sanitation, but not have to worry about getting water to use the facilities. So that team is really focused on really a technical engineering space for Innovation for Good. And then the other side of that is our associate engagement platform, which is iPrize. So this is really talking about how do we inspire and activate our associates to help us innovate and keep on kind of the cutting edge, not only from new product standpoint, but it has a sustainability lens on it with keeping those SDGs in mind. So this year we're running our iPrize program, which I'll talk about in a little bit, but our topic this year is carbon emissions. So we're focusing on environmental sustainability, asking our associates to think about what does innovation in this space look like for Kohler, and what ideas do you have? Bring them forth. So this is literally Shark Tank at Kohler, where you go and you pitch your idea to leadership and you have the potential to win incubation funding and actually move your idea forward in the business. So lots of different activities happening in all of the different pillars, but I'm lucky enough to kind of move between all of them. So I have good visibility to the great work that we're doing.
That's so cool. I really love the Shark Tank for Kohler. That's really funny.
Shark Tank, yes.
I love it. That's so cool. So it sounds like you all have a lot of stories to tell. So would you say that your team or Kohler in general embraces this idea of storytelling? And if so, how do you all do that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think one thing that's really important, because Kohler has been around for almost 150 years. So a very rich history that we have, and honestly, sustainability has been a part of it from the beginning. If we actually have a whole space in Kohler, it's the coolest thing. It's called our Kohler Archives, and it's in our communications building. It's basically a museum for all of the Kohler history that we have, because it is so rich. And you can literally go in there and page through, like see old products and old communications that went out and artifacts from all different points in history. So when we think about our story at Kohler, I think one of the most important elements to a story, honestly, is just thinking, what do you want your story to be? What is your story? What's the main focus you want to have? And I think for Kohler, that's really kind of evolved into our Safe Water for All program. So that program is housed in kind of our Better Communities pillar, but the focus of that program is on developing safe water access for communities across the globe that Kohler's in. So we execute that through what we call our water impact projects. So we're going into communities that have been identified to have a key need for access to clean water, safe sanitation, whatever that might look like. So we're really expanding that program globally. And I think our story there is really Kohler. What we're really well known for, of course, is like toilets, faucets, sinks, things like that. Our kitchen and bath business is very well known. So we think about also our biggest impact from a footprint standpoint, and especially looking at our carbon emissions impact. A lot of times it lies in the hands of the consumer and the products that they're using from Kohler. So fun fact, every time you use your faucet or your toilet or whatever, every time you use hot water, there's a carbon footprint associated with that. Mm-hmm. And Kohler as a business, we take that into account in the work that we're doing. So as we look to kind of tell the story about safe water, it's not only about how can we create, you know, better water infrastructure in different communities, but also how are we educating the consumers that may not be in an area where there's water scarcity to understand the impact that using water can actually have and how they can give back. So there's also a whole element to our Safe Water for All story for activating our consumer base around educating them on the different types of places around the globe that don't have access to safe water, but then also giving them a chance to participate and to give back to those communities through donations, and our stewardship team really heads that up. So I'd say like our big signature program is it's Safe Water for All, and believing in better is absolutely a part of that story. But Safe Water for All, I feel like that's really where a lot of our key areas of impact have come to life.
That's super cool. I really love hearing about the impact that you have globally, and also making sure to take into account the impact that has on different communities. So kind of on that same standpoint, how would you say this is all communicated in the technical sense? Do you guys have any internal reports, or subscribe to reporting platforms, or even public facing reports?
Yeah, that's a great question. I feel like the landscape is ever changing in the world of CSR and how you're reporting and how you're storytelling. What's actually really interesting is that a lot of companies now, especially when it comes to your environmental sustainability work, it's kind of assumed that you're doing something. What is a totally different story, but it's kind of assumed by the consumer now that you're at least doing something. And if you're not, then you might need to start thinking about it. So, and I'm sure you know that with all your work with WSBC in Wisconsin, the companies that are every day activating themselves around the topic. For us, we do have a public facing report. It's an annual report that we publish, and it focuses on all of the believing and better work that we do. So essentially each pillar is gone into a little bit more depth in that report. This year, I was so lucky. I had the opportunity to lead that project, and it was so cool just hearing about all the stories that are happening. It's really unfortunate that there is no possible way we could ever fit all of our stories into one public facing report. It would take years probably. But that said, it's structured in a way that we can tell kind of the key areas of impact that we made, the key achievements that we had for that year. And also what I really love about Kohler is the focus on transparency. It's not just, hey, these are all the great things we did. You know, we're not going to talk about the areas for improvement or the things that we didn't do. It's let's look at this from a holistic lens of here's the impact we made, here's the progress we have, here's where we can be better, and what we're continuing to work towards as we develop our programming each year. So I think that's really important. And I think that that's something that our report has continued to embrace over the coming years. When it comes to an environmental sustainability side, we do align with some of the technical standard reporting that's out there. So for example, we use CDP or the Carbon Disclosure Project for reporting there. The Green Masters Program with Wisconsin Sustainable Business Council, we do that every year. In fact, we just finished our application for that. and there's several kind of technical elements, especially to our environmental sustainability report. And actually this year, our team is going through kind of an overhaul assessment of what can we do next year to even further improve the structure and to also better align with some of the standards that are out there for reporting, because it does change so fast and so often. And we're doing a lot of work to kind of look at the next 5 years future of what that report looks like. So I'm really excited to see what comes out the next couple of years.
Yeah, that's so cool. Yeah, I can definitely agree. The reporting landscape changes year to year, and yeah, it can be a lot. So that's super cool to hear that you guys have done Green Masters and CDP, and of course, all of your public facing statements. So I'd like to move us to a new topic, if that's okay. So I'm pretty interested in stakeholder engagement. So who would you say some of your major stakeholders are?
Yeah, that's a great question. From my perspective, I think about it in kind of three different levels. So the first and foremost being our customers and the consumers that we interact with, the second being our associates, and then the third being our leadership. And I know that might be backwards to some people. Some people might say, no, it's the leaders, because it truly is. We are so lucky at Kohler to have amazing leadership that honestly, genuinely supports this work. And mm-hmm. they help us advance it even in spaces where we have trouble advancing it. So I know 100%, like, we are able to be what we are today because of our leadership. However, when I think about really market drivers and what even tells leadership what they need to do, it's really the consumers, it's the customers, it's our associates saying, hey, I'm interested in this, what are we doing about it? And I've seen so much activity from our associates, just passion and interest around different topics. So when I think about our stakeholders, I tend to think, like, even though our customers aren't directly engaged in our business decision-making, they're absolutely influencing every aspect of it. Even as a consumer, just the products that you buy, without reaching out to the company and saying, hey, what are your sustainability initiatives? Just making that purchasing decision right there is backing a company in what they're doing. So I think even as people think about today, how can you make an impact in your life? And when it comes to sustainability, supporting companies that are doing the work says something. And so that's why I always look at our biggest stakeholders, our customers, because they're choosing to buy Kohler. They're choosing Kohler products every single day. They're choosing Kohler experiences with our hospitality group every single day. And that choice says something, and it sends us a message too. So I know it's a little backwards, but I like to think about it that way because it's a very powerful way to think about it.
Yeah, that's super cool, especially if the customers are demanding to have more sustainable products and products that have a better impact on the world. That's really great that you all Absolutely. Listen to them first. So it sounds like employees also have a bit of a stake in this. So I guess, does company culture embrace employees as being a part of their stakeholders? And if so, what does this look like?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we think about our corporate social responsibility work, and we think about how our associates plug into that, our team is relatively small. Even across the three pillars, it may be 20 so people. But like I've said many times before, the people that are doing this work don't always have the name CSR or sustainability in their title. And that's absolutely what some of our engagement programs are for, is because our associates across Kohler, we have 33,000 associates globally. There's a lot of amazingly talented people that are helping us advance this work. And to be quite honest, as someone who's in kind of the corporate side of this, I could never do some of the work that these associates are doing. We need experts on a tactical level in key areas of the business to advance sustainability. And that's exactly what our associate engagement programs are centered around. So especially when it becomes like, let's focus on the topic of environmental sustainability. Our sustainability champions are seen as enablers for our strategy. And we, as we look to provide resources and education and information to our associates, it's centered around this larger idea that they are our active enablers in the business. They are the ones that are driving this forward. So we as a team to support them need to make sure we do a good job of educating them on, first of all, what is our strategy? What are we working towards? Why is it important? And how can you play a role in that? What is your role? If you're in HR, if you're in manufacturing, if you're in sales, whatever your role is, there's a way that you can work towards our goals with us and that you can help us reach them. So it's my job to think about what could it look like to give people all the information they need to go out and do this amazing work every day and make it a part of their job, not something extra. Because especially with the pandemic, I feel like most businesses have seen just burnout. People are tired. There's a lot of work going on. And even though we're at home, it's almost like now, like at least for me, I have less commuting time, I have more time to do work. So that's what happens. So my job is to think about how does this become something that's already part of your everyday? It's not extra work. It's not a whole new project that you need approval from your leadership. It just becomes ingrained into the processes that exist already. And with our stewardship team, that engagement from our associates there is really centered around purpose, meaning and purpose in the workplace. So our wellness team actually has structured, we have a great wellness program, and it's part of our wellness program actually incorporates sustainability and stewardship into it and says it rewards associates literally through financial reimbursement for participating in these programs. So I think first of all, we have great incentive there for participation, but also then from the stewardship standpoint, we have associates who just raise their hand and say, you know what? I'm passionate about this topic. I want to volunteer and do this, or I want to raise money for this organization. I want to give back to the community in this way. And they can bring those requests to the surface with our stewardship team and actually have that turn into something that the company supports, and then they can go ahead and do. So there's different ways for associates to engage, whether, you know, we're whatever pillar it is that they're interested in. But I think holistically as a culture at Kohler, activation of employees and finding meaning and purpose in the work that you're doing and the environment that you're in every day is one of the reigning culture facets that we have. It's very important to Kohler and to all of our associates that they feel like they can come to work and bring their authentic self. And actually that enables them to do even better work for us than it would have otherwise.
That's so cool. I love that the company can embrace the varying interests of employees. You know, when you become an employee somewhere, you have a title and your job responsibilities, but having that flexibility to really embrace other interests is awesome. So I love this idea of the sustainability champions and the community stewards. Do you have a story maybe that came from one of these associates advocating for some sort of change?
Yeah. There's so
I'm sure there's a lot.
Yes, I literally could pull up a list of all the stories. I think one of the things that sticks out to me as really exciting, first of all, because I'm still in my relative infancy of corporate social responsibility as my career, but also because I've always loved business development. In my last job, even before Kohler, that's the type of role I was in. And working at Kohler is really interesting in that we have so many different types of businesses. We've got our engines business or our power business. We've got kitchen and bath. We've got hospitality and real estate. So it's all these different types of businesses. And in my role, I was lucky enough to be able to be brought into a situation where our hospitality teams and some of the key leadership in our hospitality group said, we want to do sustainability. We want to understand what this looks like in our business. How do we do it? So I worked with my director to put together a workshop for this group to just take them through, what is our strategy? What are you doing? What types of ideas do you have? What is your vision for what this will look like 10 years down the road when you're all experts in this? And through that, we set a vision and we identified key strategic projects for them to work on. And I continue to lead that team. And it is the most exciting thing, first of all, just to see the amount of energy that exists from these associates. These are people who are on very, you know, tactical levels. They're managing restaurants. They're managing hotels. They're taking this on as extra work and they're doing the projects themselves. I come in and say, let me be a resource for you, but they are doing the work. And one of the stories that's come out of that is there's actually two that I'll talk about. So one is one of our associates, his name is Joe. And Joe literally got his job because he just kept raising his hand and saying, no, I want it to be better. I want to do more sustainable things. I want this to look differently. And finally, someone said, you know what? This guy is not being quiet. So we just need to give him a job doing what he wants to do. So he already paved the way for himself, but he has implemented a program to not only compost, but to participate in grind to energy, which is where you take all the food that can't be composted and send it to a facility that can essentially turn it into energy. Renewable energy. And we have diverted, since we started that program, almost 100,000 pounds of food from landfill because of that. And Kohler has 15 plus restaurants just in Kohler, Wisconsin alone. So All of these restaurants are participating in this program now. And this has happened within just a little over a year. Everyone's participating. And we're also working on a really cool initiative to get some green certifications for some of our restaurants. And he's leading all of that this year as well. So our hope is by the end of the year, that will be done and finished too. So there's just some really big impactful projects that have come out of there. The other one that I just think is really exciting and cool is in our American Club Hotel. So if you're not familiar, the American Club is a 5-star diamond resort. It sounds very fancy, and it is very fancy. It's very, very fancy. It's certified through Forbes. So Forbes has a set of standards that our hotel has to meet in order to be considered 5-star. And one thing that's actually been a hurdle for us in the past is that the Forbes standards are very strict. And because of that, sometimes sustainability is difficult to implement. So we have found a way to still implement really cool projects. But this year, Forbes just came out with a whole set of sustainability standards. So our team is so excited. I literally get goosebumps talking about it because we're all like, these standards are out. We're ready to do this amazing work. And now we're being even more enabled to do it because these standards are going to allow for it, which is so good to see. But one of the projects that we've worked on there, it's very simple, but in all of the hotel rooms, like when you go stay in a hotel, they always have coffee in the room, some way, shape, or form there's coffee. So they have Nespresso machines in the room. And on campus, on Kohler campus for associates, we had some associates that were just sustainability champions that said, We don't want to use K-cups because they had Keurigs. They said, we don't want to use K-cups if we can't recycle them. So let's figure out a recycling program. So they did. And so we had this recycling program for the Keurig K-cups. And our hospitality team said, well, why don't we do this in our rooms for our guests? And also so the guests don't have to do it. But the Nespresso machines, when you're done with a little pod, it pops back into a container in the back of the Nespresso machine. So they reached out to Nespresso and said, do you have any type of recycling program that we can implement where you can take these and then we can tell that story? So Nespresso said, yeah, absolutely. We have a whole program in place. All you have to do is sign up. And they actually not only can take all of our Nespresso pods from our hotels and recycle all of them, but they have this program where they actually take the aluminum from the top of the pod and they turn it into like art. So they'll create a sculpture. They created a bike out of Nespresso pod aluminum tops. It was the coolest thing.
So cool.
Yeah. So really like bizarre, random projects, but something that like you said to your earlier question, it's about the stories that you can tell, you know, and also being able to, in our hospitality team and our other businesses, make our customers and our guests a part of that story. So when they can come to Kohler and say, oh, look at this sculpture, it's made out of recycled aluminum from the rooms where guests have stayed. It's just such a cool story to tell. So I've been really, really excited and proud of that team and the multiple projects they've worked on.
I'm learning so much. I think we could do a part two to this episode.
Exactly.
But on that note, I'd love to end with one more question. So what are you most excited for in the coming year for CSR at Kohler?
That's a good question. So I think I'm excited about a lot of things, but one of the things that sticks out the most to me is because I feel like I'm the kind of person where I just need you to say yes and give me permission and I will run with something. So I'm really excited because I've been asked to run the iPrize program, our Shark Tank, our innovation incubator. And as I'm running this program, it's really cool because the goal behind iPrize is to stem innovation from all areas of the business, not just the people in new product development whose idea, their main role is to come up with new ideas. And their ideas are the ones that usually advance forward because they're in a role for that to happen. So iPrize really says, let's gather all of the knowledge and expertise from associates in every area of the business. And this year we just kicked off iPrize. So this morning, I finished up our introduction workshops to help all of the teams start coming up with their ideas and understand how to do it. And in working before we were recruiting with these groups, we're trying to ask associates to join us for this year's iPrize. We hosted a few innovation workshops. They're just fun workshops to get people excited about it and practice innovation for the first time. And we came out of some of those workshops and I had people message me afterwards saying, I didn't know that I could do this. I didn't know that I could come up with these types of ideas. And I didn't know that Kohler cared about that. And I'm really excited that, you know, I can be a part of this team in the coming year and bring these ideas to light. But that to me, it was really profound. And I wrote a LinkedIn article about it too, because it was so impactful that when you think about your life, even just as an individual, you think about your ability to control that and to influence the outcome of your life just by the decisions that you make. And one of those key elements, I think, to living a good life, having a great job, and really enjoying what you do is understanding that if you think about things differently, it can change your life. And I've seen in iPrize over and over and over again, people who step in and say, I've never thought like this before. It's made me think differently about everything I do. Everything in my job, everything at Kohler, everything in my personal life, it's made me think differently about it. And I love our consultant that we work with at iPrize. He always says, we want disruptive thinking. That's what we want. We want you to break barriers and say ideas that are so absolutely wild, no one would ever do it. But that's how you start coming up with good ideas. There are no barriers. So with the iPrize program, I'm so excited about it because it promotes the culture of innovation in that it's fearless innovation and that failure is accepted, not only accepted, but encouraged and embraced. Mm-hmm. That innovation at Kohler, as we drive that as a key cultural element in our beliefs, it's something that is 100% necessary. And failure is just a standard part of that path. Because I think often in our careers, both as young professionals and just as we get older too, failure is something we're afraid of. We're afraid of managers saying, oh, you didn't do that correctly, or, you know, I wish it would have been done better. But it's so necessary to fail. And I love that iPrize sets all of our associates up who participate to practice failing and practice hearing feedback about how you could have been better, but then also having the potential to just, you know, stem forward into something really amazing and win incubation funding. So that's like one of my multiple favorite projects of the year. But that one really, it hits a heart chord with me because of the changes that I've seen in people and the comments and feedback that I've gotten. And it's been really cool.
I can't think of a better way to end. I think mic drop right there. No, awesome. That's awesome. It's been a pleasure talking with you today. Good luck with that innovation program and your steps challenge. Can't wait to hear about both. Thank you for joining me today. And I hope you have a wonderful day and the listeners have a wonderful day, and talk to you all soon.
Sounds good. Thanks.